spoken when you appeared with Madonna, and the Madonna was interested in doing a remake at one point of this film. Could you tell the story about that, what happened?
Why do you laugh? I mean, why Madonna wouldn't be acting? Because she's a beautiful actress, the way she performs. And if you notice, Corinne Marchand looks like Madonna, or Madonna looks like Corinne Marchand. Same type of beautiful blonde with beautiful eyes. I mean, good-looking women. And at the time, it's funny because when Madonna, you know, she had taken option to see the to maybe have a film remade and she would act. And we had a meeting on the Hollywood Hills. And at that time, she was absolutely sexy, you know. Her shows were sexy photos. And when she came to see me, she had a little cotton dress, like a little girl. She had flat shoes, not hair. I mean, she looked like so normal that she would, I think she was afraid that it would say she's too, you know, too fancy to play. And she was beautiful, but looking like nobody ever saw Madonna, like a little girl of the, you know, in the French New Wave with little cotton dresses like Brigitte Bardot used to. In flat shoes and looking no makeup, nothing. Anyway, she, and once she came on TV in France, they asked her, whom you want us to invite with you? And they said, Agnes Varda. So it was a big joke on TV because nobody believed that she would know me. And she invited me on the show. but later, she had the screenplay made by somebody and didn't like so much the screen. And then her mother had a cancer and died. And it took her out of the subject. I mean, she went away and it didn't happen. But she would have been a beautiful girl. Even though at the time, when they asked me if I wanted to do a remake of something, I had thought of that beautiful black woman who wasted, tell me her name, the one who played the bodyguard, you know. Yeah, and she would have been a black woman afraid of AIDS.
Yes.
I would have, at the time where AIDS was just a death sentence, you know, I thought it would have been different to make in America with another subject, but since Madonna doesn't look very black, then she changed, and then we forgot, and then it's passed.
But I mean, you mentioned it was like a little joke that there were like a few seconds that you took out of the film and you re-edited it for DVD.
No.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
No.
You know, we had to restore the film. And it's a long work because you have to go to the lab and check. They check the negative and then they scan and then they do it in another format. And then we go to color timing, even black and white timing. No, because I got so bored to do it, I said I should make something that I know it's a change. And in a sequence where she enters the sculpture studio to meet her friend who is model, she passes the door, and I thought the cut was not very well made. So I cut 5 images, which is a quarter of a second.
Oh.
That's my change.
Yeah.
So you have to be absolutely maniac if you are able to find out where I cut 5 frames. So it's not, I didn't want to change the film, and I don't regret, and I never refuse what I did before, you know. I did it, but that was a little, I would say, in coquetry, you know.
Yes.
A coquetry, an editor coquetry. So don't even speak about it. Nobody sees it.
Well, except that it's on the DVD. You pointed out in this little documentary.
I told the truth.
Yes.
On the bonus. You know, when we edit films, you know, I think people should have something more than the film itself. So I have this additional thing that it's one bonus. And I say, because I did learn some Latin, so one bonus, 2 bunny. So I have bunny in my DVD when they come out.
And one of the things that amazes me about your work is that you invented the DVD extra before DVDs existed. Because it seems to me that one of the great things that you do in your films, which in fact you also find in Jacques Demy's films, is that you index your own films in a certain way. That you, sort of like look back at your work and then rearrange pieces and characters.
Depends. And sometimes it is needed. I made a film, I know that played here, called The Gleaners. Gleaners et la Glaneuse in French.
But yes, The Gleaners and I.
Yeah. This translated by The Gleaners and I, which I don't like too much. But it's difficult.
Yes.
No, it's because it's difficult in the American language to say the gleaner and the gleaneress, or the gleaner, a woman, you know, so that did an eye.
Yes.
Well, okay. So I made that film, as you know, which is related to people, you know, who eat and pick on the floor what we throw away. So it has a lot of things around, but it's mostly about waste, about people who need the leftover to exist and to eat. And the film was, I must say, a real success. And where I would go, people say, beautiful film. And then I say, well, the people in the film are beautiful because it's a documentary. I was at the service of the subject. I did a good film, I did a good editing, but the real good ones are in the film. And then the more I say that, I question what it is to do a documentary about real people who are in trouble. So it pushed me to do, it's response in answer to one of your remarks, is that I did a film called 2 years later.
Yes.
And I went back to meet and try to meet all these people have been filming in The Gleaners. Some of them were in a better shape. One was dead. Some were in better situation. But sometimes it was difficult to find them because they are homeless and most of the time they don't have an address. So I had to travel in France to find, I had a clue to her that they were here or there. So I succeeded more or less to see them all. And among them was one, because I had shown them the film, because I think we should respect the film we film when it's a documentary. And I had succeeded to make screening for them or giving them the other time, it was a VHS. And most of them had seen the film. Then I meet a man in front of the station, the one who is so extraordinary, the one who teaches people, you know, a volunteer, teaches French to people coming from Africa. And he's in the street, and we made on purpose say, okay, you saw The Gleaners, what we think about it, and he says, well, it's not a bad documentary, but you should not be in it. I don't need to see you. I don't care about your illness. And it was interesting because he had a point of view, which it is true, I could have been disappearing of the film, the subject was The Gleaner. So it's interesting by continuing to, I mean, in a way, retaking the film as seen by other people or remembering what it means, what it meant for them. It's not dropping the case, you know, because in the documentary, sometimes we do something about people that we just go elsewhere. And they are still in their misery, still in their problem, especially in documentaries about people in bad situation. So I did 2 years later, that came out.
Well, yes, and in fact, a wonderful thing on the DVD, that's why I was thinking about how great you are with extras, is that if, while you're looking at The Gleaners, les glaneuses, a potato, you know, like there's a point when a character appears when a potato it flashes in the upper right-hand corner, and if you hit with your remote control the potato, then you get to see this character later. So it becomes an interactive sort of way of accessing, of following up the threads of the different characters.
They keep me company, I keep company with them. I bought potatoes before we... No, but it's serious. Here in the University of Chicago, in the South, at the Logan Center, have an exhibition because I became a visual artist 10 years ago, and I have a beautiful installation about potatoes, and especially heart-shaped potatoes that you saw me picking in The Gleaners, that I made a triptych, and I wreathed potatoes on as a carpet. You should see that. It's worth taking the bus. Now, I'm back.
Somehow this seems connected to me to the interest in trees you have in all of your films, like even in Cleo when he's talking about the
dinner. Yes. But to speak about the trees in Cleo, I'm glad you brought back Cleo because I think that's a film that's so... It's good to see a full room, believe me. For a filmmaker, this is a treat. to have a full room. Yes. And it makes me feel that it's worth it making what I do, because some people come to see it. So I'm blessed, you know.
Yes, I think there must be people who have questions here. So could we have questions? There are questions that people would like to ask. There's a microphone, I think, up here, if anyone here does. Or is it here? Sorry.
If they don't, I know you have 12 questions ready on your paper.